Thank you, everyone, for settling in. I know it was a short lunch break. A year ago, almost to this day, Professor ShiPu Wang arrived at our museum for a senior Terra Foundation fellowship to work on his newest book project, The Other American Moderns. He was a fantastic colleague to have around. Thoughtful, questioning, diligent, and I was thrilled when he accepted my invitation to chair a session today. ShiPu Wang is Associate Professor of Art History and Visual Culture at the University of California, Merced, is the author of Becoming American, The Art and Identity Crisis of Yasuo Kuniyoshi, published in 2011. He has published his research in major journals, both in English and Chinese, including American Studies, the Special Art and Cultural Institutions issue of AAPI Nexus, Yushu Journal of Contemporary Chinese Art, and several issues of the Journal of Aesthetic Education by the Taiwan National Center for Arts Education. His essay, Japan Against Japan, U.S. Propaganda and Yasuo Kuniyoshi's Identity Crisis, appeared in the spring 2008 issue of American Art and won our 2008 Patricia and Philip Frost Essay Award. Wang was a 2014 Terra Foundation Senior Fellow at American Art, so please welcome him to the stage to chair our next session.
Thank you, Amelia. I don't know how you move mountains, but you do. And thanks to you, we're all here. And thanks to Terra Foundation, as well as Sam, for having us here. I want to begin my remarks today with a brief look at a particular historical moment, 1937, to be exact, in which American artists were grappling with many of the key issues that this symposium and our panel are considering. Writing in an exhibition statement for the ACA Gallery's painting by New York Chinese-Japanese artists in September of 1937, artist Harry Gottlieb, president of Artists Union at the time, registered an unequivocal protest against the recent layoffs of artists from the Works Progress Administration, one of the major New Deal programs that President Roosevelt and his supporters established. The provision of the relief appropriation bill, which brought about the dismissal of 500,000 needy workers from the WPA, was an attack on the living standards of the American people, Gottlieb wrote. The Roosevelt administration had encountered sustained challenge from their political opponents, who managed to add on provisions requiring federally funded projects to hire only U.S. citizens, resulting in immigrant artists losing a major source of their income as employees of the WPA. Among the dismissed were Chinese and Japanese-born artists who had been active in the U.S., some for decades, but were ineligible for naturalization due to the Immigration Act of 1924. It was a U.S. federal law that limited the immigration quotas based on national origins and excluded all Asians from being able to obtain immigration status. This was an expansion of the 1917 Act, which launched a restrictive law, immigration law, that denied entry for those born in the so-called Asiatic barred zone, except Japan, the Philippines, and China, whose citizens were already barred from immigration under the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882. The citizenship provision in the WPA funding essentially amounted to group discrimination, Gottlieb decried, and it represented what he called the xenophobic forces, quote, most reprehensible form, unquote, of reaction in the name of protecting Americans' economic interests that, in fact, deprived the country of a diverse pool of artistic talent. The closing sentences in Gottlieb's statement demonstrate a deft maneuver to shift the focus of a nativist debate to a demand for highest quality of art. Americans have a right to expect from the art project the best work available, irrespective of race, color, or creed. The Artists Union of New York, one of the sponsors of this exhibition, calls upon all progressive forces to sponsor legislation that will put an end to such despicable discrimination. By framing access to quality fine arts as an American democratic right, Gottlieb reminded his fellow progressive that it was not enough to protest on paper or canvas in hopes of eradicating discriminatory policies. Artists must get involved in real political activism. Gottlieb spoke out against the dismissal on behalf of the diasporic Chinese and Japanese artists because of his position as the union's president and a leftist artist. But one could also argue that he was compelled by his own experience of being an ethnic and religious minority in diaspora, for he too was an immigrant, having moved with his Jewish parents from Romania to the U.S. at the age of 12 in 1907. The exhibition forward could thus be regarded as both a multivalent call to action based on an ideological conviction and a proclamation of solidarity informed by his personal identification with other emigrant artists and their plight. Here I have just one painting from that exhibition in 1937 and the names of the 18 artists who showed there. Many of these artists and many more artists of Asian descent were in fact participants in the first American Artist Congress as well. Gottlieb's statement was only one of numerous articulations of the entanglement of art, nationalism, race, and politics that constituted the American artistic milieu in the 1930s. Some forcefully rejected the notion of racial art or using race and place of birth as a criterion in evaluating an artist's work. Maya Shapiro insisted, for example, what unites these American artists stylistically is the common culture in which they grew up and produced their art. Artist Lynn Ward took up Shapiro's point and reiterated that neither an artist's blood, meaning race, nor geography or country of birth, determines the artwork's character or quality. It was instead a combination of forces in the cultural environment that and the social situation in which he finds himself that shapes the work of an American artist. Both Shapiro and Ward had geopolitics in mind as they aimed to dispel, among other things, the myth of quote-unquote racial purity, one of the major tenets of Nazism. Within the US context, these artists' writers, along with influential African-American thinkers and writers such as W.E.B. Du Bois, Alan Locke, and Langston Hughes all recognized art and race were always ideological and political. Their proposals for how to interrogate the intersection of the two greatly differed, of course, but a common thread in their sometimes conflicting positions was that they sought to encourage a kind of inclusive American art that embraced both endogenous and exogenous influences while also accommodating divergences and even incongruences. Transcending artists' national, racial, and cultural differences, however, was an ostensibly utopian belief in art's universal efficacy in articulating challenges confronting disparate minority communities and, most crucial, effecting broader cultural and social political amelioration. I brought up these brief examples to foreground a few key points that I think help frame our presentations today. One, it is useful to remember, and we've been reminded by this morning's sessions, that the so-called international or global turn in American art, that's the focus of this symposium, is not a new development. American artists, native-born and diasporic alike, have always had to grapple with the fraught but productive relationship between art, nationalism, and politics of identity concerning race and ethnicity. In other words, American art has always been thoroughly political and multicultural, with contributors of various racial and cultural backgrounds shaping what American art was, is, or should be. So for the purposes of this panel, one could argue that racial ethnic identification formation is thus one of the core contentious issues in American art that cannot be properly studied without understanding ideological battles and geopolitics that fuel such artistic production and its reception in both the US and international context. Indeed, race or the politics associated with it has been and continues to ignite firestorms of controversy, some fabricated, as the passionate debates and protests surrounding these exhibitions with their own particular sets of challenges have demonstrated, including Harlem on My Mind in 1969, The West as America in 1991, and the latest and last Whitney Biennial in 2014, name only three high-profile examples, among many others. Perhaps this is stating the obvious, especially in front of this highly informed audience, but it is worth noting that in recent decades, there has been an increased number of ambitious publications and exhibitions examining the heterogeneity of American art as produced by its culturally diverse contributors. Several art historians have provided cogent and insightful analyses of the development of critical theories and methods for the study of identities in American art and visual culture, and I'm highlighting Angela Miller's and Tongyang Sheehan's two articles, being two excellent examples among quite a few others, and some of the authors are actually in the audience. Some of the publications that came out in the past decade, as seen on this far from exhaustive list, offer provocative and productively divergent approaches, ranging from focusing on analyzing an artist's formal visual strategies without the burden or bias of having to factor in the artist's race or ethnicity in every analytical turn, to seeing every image through the so-called racial lens that enables the scholar and viewer to recognize the prejudiced systems in which such imagery is produced and received. A few books expand the investigations and methodologies by going beyond the single focus, single race focus, such as Cherie Smith's Enacting Others and Jacqueline Francis' Making Race. Presented as a collection of case studies, these books offer thought-provoking comparative examinations of the creative strategies deployed by artists of various racial ethnic groups, whose works illustrate the fluidity and performativity of identity formation that in turn question the received historical and theoretical understanding of what we call racial art. Dr. Francis is with us today. We'll revisit her term, critical race art history, and examine what it has accomplished and what still needs to be unpacked, reconceptualized, and perhaps revitalized in this current cultural and political moment. As a few ambitious publications have indicated, such as the recent Companion to American Art and the monumental five-volume series, The Image of the Black in Western Art, there is also an increased vital recognition of transnational exchanges of critical thoughts and approaches in studying the interconnectedness of artistic production, cultural and racial ethnic discourses, socio-political movements, and ramifications of geopolitics. These books, along with some exhibitions, have managed to contribute to and provide nuance for the so-called internationalization of American art history by involving scholars who deploy multidisciplinary methods in expanding and situating in a global context the study of a thoroughly diverse American art and its contributors. Our panelist, Rita Gonzalez, will address the, quote, complicated institutional brokering of identities and the differing, yet at times overlapping, stakes for the fields of Latino and Latin American artistic production and scholarship, end of quote, from the perspective of a curator who closely collaborates with many international artists, curators, and scholars. In the area of research concerning the visual production of Americans of Asian descent, arguably still very much the minority within the field of American art history, although the growth of the Asian American population is thoroughly heterogeneous, and their increasing impact on the U.S. labor force cannot be overlooked, transnationally oriented efforts are emerging as well. For example, a new journal, Asian Diasporic Visual Cultures in the Americas, aims to, quote, encourage the hemispheric transnational study of multiple Americas with diverse indigenous and diasporic populations, and features multidisciplinary scholarship on the intersections between visual culture studies and the study of Asian diasporas across the Americas. One of the organizations supporting the journal is Diasporic Asian Art Network, co-organized by Margot Machida, a pioneering scholar in Asian American art history, and Alexandra Chang, director of global arts programs at New York University. The network's broader transnational and transdiasporic orientation hopes to bring together an international community of artists and scholars to participate in a productive discussion that is global in scope and includes what might be broadly defined as Asian American art. With an eye toward the global, there are also projects that leverage geopolitics, the long and tumultuous relations between the U.S. and countries in the Pan-Asian region, and issues of migration and displacement as critical means of expanding studies of the visual production of diasporic peoples. An example is the latest special... An example is the latest special issue of the Asian American Literary Review, entitled Recollecting the Vietnam War, that contains a curated presentation of visual and literary works that investigate the long-lasting impact of the Vietnam-American War, 40 years since its devastating conclusion, as far as the U.S. involvement was concerned, on the cultural production of diasporic Vietnamese, some of whom choose to live, work, and shuttle between the U.S. and Vietnam and its neighboring countries. But it should be noted that many of the special issues contributors are associated with a diasporic Vietnamese artist network, whose mission is to, quote, promote visibility and understanding of Vietnamese diasporic art, and to facilitate self-expressions in ways that are not restricted by external expectations and pressures, as, for instance, the constant pressure to discuss the trauma of war and displacement, end of quote. Their publication, An Anthology of Southeast Asian Women in Diaspora, demonstrates the kind of variety and richness of art and literature produced by diasporic women that we certainly need to see more of in books, exhibitions, curricula, and public programs. Foregrounding the aftermath of geopolitical trauma and consequences, our panelist, Dr. Asma Naeem, will indeed examine works by three very different artists through the critical lens of displacement. And that brings me to present to you our three panelists. You already had a preview of the slide. Going over their credentials and accomplishments would require more time than we are allotted here, and I'm sure you're looking forward to their papers instead of my introduction. But I will simply say that it has been a real pleasure working with them and brainstorming with them throughout many different conversations. And as we can see, their presentations offer a myriad of perspectives that I think illustrate the exciting diversity and possibilities in this area of research. With that, please join me in welcoming our first speaker, Dr. Jacqueline Francis.
Thank you, everyone here. Thanks very much to Sam, to Tara, to Amelia, of course, to ShiPu, and you all. I have failed at critical rate art history. And I don't mean failure in the productive ways. Failure as a cause for celebration in self-proclaimed low theory precincts, and failure also cheered by observers who worry that critical race art history would take attention away from those stories of struggle, striving, surviving, thriving, and overcoming, and so wanted critical race art history to fail. My brand of critical race art history has failed because its theory, the framing idea that racialization is a form of differentiation that demands critical, comparative study, seems perhaps dry, abstract, and indulgent, when, in an unexpected visual turn, our current technologies capture and document racist violence against politically identified black and brown people in many parts of the world. To speak of the racializing process also might sound universalizing, although that has never been my intent. Apart from critical race art history, there is an abundance of good research and writing about race and race relations, both of which sometimes operate as euphemisms for racism. This kind of writing often invokes the name of critical race art history. In many instances, authors consider numerous artists or art movements, and the preferred framework is a case study. Each article, section, or book chapter lays out the story of the painter A's life and career, followed by that devoted to painter B's, painter C's, and so forth. The case study is informative and useful, especially when the writer makes links between and among the artist. Yet the case study format can also be atomizing. It doesn't automatically raise the imbricating questions that images like this do, the ones that critical race art history and critical race visual cultural studies raise. What are the strategies that make race seem real? What approaches are renewed and updated? What are the innovations for racializing? Critical race art history depends upon comparisons and contrast, qualities that lie at the heart of racial representation. They long have. Race was clearly, curiously, and problematically rendered across lineages and species in the 19th century, British context, as the historian David S. Vineman has shown us. Race was majority and minority, big and small, all things great and beautiful. Over time, race, even with conceived typologies of regional, national, and ethnic particularity, has come to mean minority difference in the West and elsewhere. We presently live in North America and Europe with complex, essentialized notions of race. In these, race simply means black, a kind of insufficiency and danger, a difference that is the same over time and in various locales, especially because it is positioned in a dichotomy with whiteness, which passes itself as neutral, normal, and ahistorical. But these times are a-changing. As it has been widely reported, the prediction is that by 2050, white European Americans will no longer comprise the US majority. The future is now. In California, where I live, the demographic shift has already taken place. We are figuring out what will whiteness mean over the next couple of years. How will present-day minorities identify once they are the majority? I don't know. But power and the vying for it won't go away. Whiteness won't go away either. It is for this reason that I look back at where critical race art history started for me. In 2000, I wrote a state of the field paper for a College Art Association panel dedicated to topics in African American art history. A lightly edited version of the CAA talk entitled Writing African American Art History was published in American Art, along with essays by senior scholars Marianne Kahlo, James Small, Richard J. Powell, Deborah Willis, and Floyd Coleman. Both the CAA talk and my American art contribution addressed the research and contextualization of African American artist production, the critical response to it, and the presentation of these diverse bodies of work in survey texts and in a variety of exhibitions, proposing cultural themes and proclaimed racial aesthetics. My remarks called for a more comparatively stylistically driven research into shared and recurrent issues among artists, black and non-black, and an unpacking and rigorous thinking about the category of African diaspora art, which by the 1990s seemed mostly to designate everything black that was not made by black Americans or by persons from the African continent. In addition, I pose two rhetorical questions. Are we privileging, fetishizing, and even trying to concretize the margins? Will we always look for race in the same place? And here, today, right now, I shall digress in order to shoehorn a third question into this discussion, one that Hammons's Concerto in Black and Blue generates. In addition to the visual regime, what about the other means through which racial identities are constructed? Through sound, touch, taste, and smell. Again, I digress. Back in 2003, because I feared privileging, fetishizing, and even concretizing the margins, I stopped looking for race as a singular term. In doing so, I was moving toward a different model and mindset. I wondered, is racism, or is anti-racism, like feminism? Both are intellectual commitments and political movements. And I was trying to figure out methodology and vocabulary. My conception of critical race art history followed the leads of scholars scrutinizing the representation of racial types and difference, with feminist, psychoanalytic, social constructivist, historiographic, queer studies, and other contextualist methods. James Smalls, Kavanagh Mercer, Judith Wilson, Kirk Savage, John Davis, Margaret Vendries, and Rebecca Zurier shone a light for me. Their projects and others helped me think about Orientalism, primitivism, and of course whiteness, which I wrote in that essay and in the talk was an obvious target for scrutiny. So Lion, which had been taught to me as a graduate student as being about class and gender, struck me as also being about race, which I'd never heard before. Patrick Lion was forging American whiteness in the 19th century. For certain, authors that I admire, anthropologists, art historians, historians, philosophers, scholars of film, literature, and visual and cultural studies, have researched whiteness and inspired my thinking. Their projects demythologize whiteness, analyze its constructions, and call it out. In some of these publications, and in many others that I have not shown today, whiteness is made shameful, abhorrent, and ultimately irredeemable. It is no wonder that some have sought to abandon it. It's a new white flight. But that's no solution, is it? Because the flight from whiteness rarely produces a byproduct critique of the conception of pure, absolute, and monolithic races and identities. When the fiction of the resolutely benevolent and divine-like white subject is questioned, and maybe slightly diminished, it seems then that such characteristics are assigned to the formally degraded other, reifying it. The transvaluation is nothing to cheer about, for it is an overly simplified equation that operates on the order of four legs good, two legs bad, as in Orwell's Animal Farm. Compliance-driven multiculturalism and diversity initiatives and inclusion rhetoric in North America and the United Kingdom rely on this logic, or perhaps what I should call its illogic. They are quick fixes for historical and contemporary acts of racism, elitism, exclusion, discrimination, oppression, violence, and aggression. Merely adding artists of color to survey texts and conceiving new global art histories doesn't entirely stabilize, or destabilize, I should say, or put nearly enough pressure on canonical accounts. Oftentimes, these moves come off as undisguisedly supplemental and cynical, and they are, as spoofed here. Institutional multiculturalism, as Cabinia Mercer has called it, aptly describes the effort to change environments without addressing the constellation of ordered and classified bodies in search of unity, wholeness, privilege, power, and entitlement. But again, I think the acts of making whiteness can be seen if we pledge to look for them and dedicate ourselves to doing so. We could work from the obvious and indisputably true fact. All subjects are constructing and reconstructing identities, and proclaiming identifications that speak to desires of belonging to and differentiating from. So when I'm teaching abstract expressionism in the classroom, following Amelia Jones and others, I speak of Jackson Pollock as a racialized body, because he was. He was one constructing masculinity, whiteness, American Westernness, American nationality. He hoped that his artist body would be linked to positive archetypes of the American West and be set in contrast to effeminate stereotypes of the European artist, the cosmopolitan New Yorker, and the artist in general. Pollock carved out identities as did his contemporaries, here presented, as Barnett Newman hoped, looking like bankers, and as Harold Rosenberg believed and later wrote, as the emblems of American diversity. If the poet and critic Rosenberg's objective was to hail and celebrate the impact of multiculturalism avant la lettre, the sociologist Stuart Hall had a parallel interest, articulated decades later, in the moments of recognition that he discussed. In the 1980s, Hall wrote about the politics of difference differently as he assessed those tumultuous years in Great Britain. None of what we think about ethno-racial and national identities and identifications, including those of majorities, has ever been just there, now and then. Among these, the iconographies of race have to be made strange, in every sense of the word, because they are. Artist negotiations with these realities were the subjects of my book, Making Race, Modernism and Racial Art in America. In my examination of the work of Max Weber, Malvin Gray Johnson, Yasuo Kuniyoshi, and the reception to those works, I found that these New York expressionists slash realist painters worked in the traditional genres, portraiture, landscape, still life, and carefully experimented with figural abstraction, and I organized my book chapters around that, not as the Kuniyoshi chapter, the Weber chapter, and the Johnson chapter, not the Russian Jewish white guy, not the black American guy, not the Japanese American guy, but the portrait chapter, the genre chapter, the genre picture chapter, the still life chapter, the landscape chapter. Differently, many interwar critics saw the modernism of their painters, of their paintings and prints, as not as formal innovation, but instead as predetermined atavistic generations, as an inevitably racial art emitting from American minorities. When I started the Making Race project, I saw these three artists operating in an interstice, having little room to maneuver. But by the end, I saw how the creations that they made, the perceptions of them, and the made truths of difference, that is, different differences, was both enabling and constraining simultaneously. Each of these artists was racialized by observers, and they self-racialized. At some junctures of their careers, they rejected the essentialist categorizations. At other times, they embraced the very same typologies, and even expanded them as effective strategies of being modern and modernist, following modernism's broad trajectories mapped on originality, creativity, and peculiar individuality. Racial art worked for Johnson, Kuniyoshi, and Weber, and worked against them, too. The takeaway is that identity politics, for better and for worse, often considered a phenomenon and even as a symptom of the 1980s and the 1990s, has a much longer history. Are we today that far away from racial art of the early 20th century in North America and in the United Kingdom? And I make note of the transatlantic dynamic because of Janet Wolfe's important research on the overdetermined readings of the work of Mark Gertler and other Anglo-Jewish artists in her terrific book, Anglo-Modern. Here, Byron Kim tries to create space and distance from racial art and that way of thinking. Kim is self-evidently communicating something about paint and skin, a wonderful play on the two literary figures of speech, namely metonym as well as synecdoche. Kim is not only troubling centuries of Western academic art training that claimed flesh color for certain subjects and not for others, he's not only referencing suprematist and color field traditions. He is also asserting, no, insisting, he is insisting upon the chromatic relationship among a network of bodies and across individual bodies. Further, I would say, applying a phrase from literary scholar Kalpana Seshadri-Cook's, skin color is exposed as part of the whole, as one of those major and minor details upon which race as a regime is thriving and relying to shore up its symbolic position. Yet, considering the grid structure of Kim's painted panels and the names of the sitters on the wall labeled next to this ever-expanding piece, I find it difficult not to think back to the ethnological interpretations that I showed at the beginning of my talk. If synecdoche seems to visualize Stuart Hall's summation in his essay, Minimal Selves, that is that, quote, all identity is constructed across difference, does Kim's positioning and ordering of identity simultaneously keep identities boxed in? Furthermore, do all grids, modern, modernist, postmodernist, all of them alike, do the same thing? How can we measure the different ways that differences differ? The last question is activated in this iteration of Sharon Hayes' action with audience participation project called In the Near Future. In various cities, New York, London, Warsaw, and Vienna, Hayes stood on the streets, holding signs that evoked historical picket protest. Her audience documents them, and then displayed hundreds of those images as many more projections on gallery walls as installation with slide carousels clicking away. Here she invokes Glenn Ligon's projects of the 1980s expanded into the 2000s with the same theme of the Memphis sanitation workers' strike of 1968. But I'm going to jump back. In the near future, the frisson experienced by viewers aware of the artist's appropriative acts, that is to say, Hayes's and Ligon's, means that a past has been evoked, summoned, and recontextualized for those who witness it and talk to her about it. In an interview of 2009, Hayes differentiated from her use of the strike and Withers's photo of it from Ligon's. Ligon's work, she said, was, quote, a conscious and specific translation, a filtering, an excision, and an anesthetizing of the conflict. Hers, in contrast, she said, was, quote, an action, a labor, and it was pedagogic. It was, she said, also not performance. According to Hayes, In the Future was, and again, these are her words, quote, kind of a demonstration that acts for a form of critical viewership, demonstration that is a communication and a telling. It's a narrativizing that recognizes the position from which it's narrating. It's a very privileged space to be in. The social practice of Hayes is in the future, although I'm not sure that's a phrase she would embrace, resonates with another artist, Andrea Fraser. Andrea Fraser has, of course, revised her thinking about institutional critique in recent years. And to be clear, Fraser wants nothing to do with social practice. Her interest in works like Men on the Line, KPFK, 1972, runs parallel to Hayes, Both Fraser and Hayes bring identities and identifications, their own and others, into the fore. Men on the Line is a performance whose text is taken from a 1972 radio program in which four men talked on air about their relationships and about gender politics in that era. Transcribing the audio recording and speaking all the voices, Fraser regards their comments as historical and cultural, collective and personal. Even on the occasions that their own words trip up the men of Men on the Line, revealing their shortcomings, Fraser's presentation doesn't send them up as buffoons. That is, Men on the Line is not the kind of critique that Fraser is best known for. Fraser stated in 2012 that she was even rejecting this notion of critique in favor of a practice that, quote, was a space of ongoing investigation and reflexive analysis, end quote. Reflecting her belief that we are all in and of the institution, Fraser wants to sit with the uncomfortable and the not immediately resolvable as it pertains to the political and as they manifest in mistakes and in missteps. In that same 2012 interview that I've just mentioned, Fraser asserted this, it's a long quote, "What I always get uncomfortable with, and I think we do this in the art world very often, is the strong desire to jump over that investigation and say, okay, now we know what the good thing is to do, and we're on the good side. And that's a very defensive maneuver as far as I'm concerned," says Fraser. "I have a firm belief that it's much more productive," she says, "to not say, oh, okay, we're doing the right thing, we're good people. Instead," she says, "we should say, no, this is not the right thing. This is not the right thing. This is how we're doing the wrong thing. This is how we're participating in the reproduction of steeply hierarchical and unequal relations. This is how we're participating in the reproduction of economic inequality. This is how we're participating in relationships of domination. And it's very unpleasant to focus on that. But that examination is exactly what art and certain artistic traditions have made a space for and have developed as a paradigm." End of Fraser's quote. Might critical race art history be a place to make mistakes? That is my personal reckless proposal. In this recent documentary, the filmmaker Vargas invites participants to get uncomfortable together, and they don't. The poster invitation to a workshop series that has just started at the University of San Francisco, another campus where I teach, is a proffered velvet glove. According to the USF's Intercultural Center's Facebook page, 35 people attended the first session on Wednesday. I was not among them. I will end with a mistake, a condition and arena in which critical race art history could reside. A graduate student of mine at the California College of the Arts, Emily K. Holmes, introduced me to this image. It is a photo of someone holding a digital camera, moments after she's taken a selfie captured on the camera screen. This photo went viral after its maker, Jaws Wang, uploaded it to her online blog. In response to the question, programmed in as part of the camera's digital face recognition software, Wang playfully posted on her blog, her own personal blog, quote, "Racist camera, no, I did not blink, I'm just Asian," end quote. In her MA thesis, Emily Holmes brilliantly addressed the racist attitudes brought to analog photography, such as the Shirley card we saw earlier, efficiently transferred to digital photography and to social media. Changes have been made in the film stock industry and among camera manufacturers. Multiracial models have been hired and new color standards established. Yet, as Andrea Fraser advises, there's much to remain uncomfortable with for a little while longer. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody, for coming back after lunch. I'm always grateful when people do return after having a nice meal. And I want to thank my office neighbors, Sam, and also the Terra Foundation. And I'd also like to thank Amelia Gerlitz, who has superhuman powers. To introduce the set of issues I will be discussing today, I offer two works for your consideration. The first, Venice, 2015, Korean-Canadian artist Ginny Yu's work entitled, Don't They Ever Stop Migrating. Conceived in response to the current mass migration crisis, this installation piece features black ink brushstrokes on fabric draped throughout a room. The accompanying soundscape, appropriating Alfred Hitchcock's 1963 classic, The Birds, amplifies the work's emotional valence. You scrambled dialogue from the film and layered them to dizzying, discomforting effect. Phrases such as, they're frightening the children, swirl in our ears as we try to follow the swarm of dark slashes, inducing feelings of chaos and decenteredness that mark those displaced. The second, Boston, circa 1680. The self-portrait of Thomas Smith, an individual whose biography remains unconfirmed, but is widely believed to be a mariner portraitist working in Boston at the time. Scholars have noticed the thematics of vanitas and mortality with the skull and the poem addressing the spiritual crossing to the afterlife, thus symbolizing a metaphysical journey of sorts. But displacement is also pictured in what is either a window or canvas nearby, which shows Barbary North American Muslim pirates in battle with Dutch and British ships. By inserting this global scene, Smith suggests the dislocation of crew, passengers, and perhaps even himself for the sake of empire far away. Both of these works, then, with very different sensibilities, picture displacement, what I define as the moving of a person from a fixed geographical position and identity. Both, in some sense or another, picture what I call the leaving of a self behind. More specifically, both displacements involve North America and implicate transoceanic journeys, real or imagined, by either artist or subject. To date, Americanists have been hesitant to trace the paths of displacement embedded within these kinds of works, to pursue vectors of movement outside of our country, and explore entanglements of intercultural exchange abroad. By placing the work of Smith and Yu within a historical continuum, though, some interesting, if not difficult, questions begin to arise. For example, what about those displacements that occur before the contemporary moment, such as Smith's, from periods where our postmodern analyses of migration and mobility would seem anachronistic? And what about those artists who aren't American-born and come here much later in life, or whose entire career is peripatetic? In other words, how will the status of American art history change if we examine artists whose cultural identities are at once global and American? And finally, why hasn't the study of displacement moved from the margins of American art history, as typified in Smith's work, to a more expansive, provocative space like that of Yu's installation? In my talk today, I will discuss the complexities of considering displacement within our discipline, and then turn to my own still-developing project about the partition of India as a case study. To begin our exploration of such issues, there are several points to consider. First, as Mary Douglas has shown us, oh, by the way, I didn't get the memo about showing the book of the author as a slide, so I apologize. First, as Mary Douglas has shown us, in pure socio-spatial terms, individuals who move out of their fixed place are considered disruptive, perhaps even more so than the objects they create.
Our discipline from its earliest days has been defined by categorizations and taxonomies. Knowledge flows because objects are mapped, labeled, identified, and have their place. However overdetermined, this taxonomic impulse exists partly because American art was structured on geopolitical boundaries, containment, attempts to fix national identity. Displaced artists, flout these taxonomies. They scramble them by virtue of their transcending borders and defying facile identifications. Indeed, as Finbar Barry Flood has noted, quote, artistic and political geography is not coincident with physical and political geography, end quote. We now understand that America was far more global in its early days than previously realized, with cosmopolitan circuits of colonization, trade, and maritime activities. Due to such shifting patterns of displacement, the cultural contours of our nation's artistic production, neither monolithic nor orderly, are constantly changing. Second, and on a related note, displacement is tricky for our field because historiography in general has been traditionally and inexorably linked to nation building. We now understand that earlier American art histories were shaped by such problematic orthodoxies as American exceptionalism, as we discussed earlier today, and manifest destiny. Orthodoxies that, upon reflection, were built upon anxieties about other populations as stakeholders in our nation. Thus, to investigate cultural actors whose biographies or contributions fall outside traditional American structures would pierce our mythologies and demote our status in global geopolitics. And finally, I should note this work is upstairs here in our National Portrait Gallery. It's cheeky, but it's dark, so I would suggest you go take a look at it. Finally, studying displacement in a truly global framework requires a nuanced understanding of politics, histories, and various intangible aspects of social exchange beyond the contours of the United States and Europe. As historian Tom Bender notes, we need to look beyond the, quote, Eurocentric genetic chain and dissolve barriers between history and ethnology, end quote. This requires the Americanist to become both less comfortable and more familiar with places beyond Europe. In other words, to become more cosmopolitan. To be sure, many scholars in our field have pursued, in landmark scholarship, the displacement of objects across territories and borders, oceans and cultures. And I am so glad we had that discussion this morning about the Things panel, and I look forward to continuing the discussion after we present our papers today. This emphasis of following the artifact doesn't necessarily mean that the agent of the artwork is overlooked, but in its gestalt, the methodology stresses the global mobility of an object and the materialities of a transcultural encounter. As theoretically productive as this has been, I would argue that objects are imbued with the identities of those who shape them. If we think about it, the process of displacement entails an artist searching for correspondence in a new place, finding cultural homologies, translating, misinterpreting, discovering ambiguities, and adjusting to hybrid modes of self-consciousness. In all of these ways, practices of displacement can create wholly new forms of representation. To put it simply, in circulation, both things and people transform and reinvent themselves. Studying artwork in terms of the displacements of its maker may allow us to understand the many mutable facets and strategies of social identity and gain fuller humanistic understandings of intercultural contact. My current project, Leaving Yourself Behind, The Partition of India and Its Aftermath in American Art, probes these very practices of displacements. It imagines the somewhat unusual linking of three artists, American photographer Margaret Bourke White, and two diasporic South Asian American artists, Zarina and Shazia Sekunder, who are both alive and living and working in New York today. Specifically, I analyze all three artists and their artistic production in terms of the 1947 partition, the division of British-ruled India. Partition led to a humanitarian crisis with the creation of two different nations, the sovereign Hindu-majority country of India and the newly Muslim-majority country of Pakistan to the west. Each of the artists I examined left her home and crossed the Atlantic, either going to India or immigrating to the United States, and created poignant works that deal with this traumatic event or its underlying religious conflict. Partition is arguably the largest mass migration in history. Amidst bloodshed and suffering, approximately 1 million people were killed and 12 million were displaced. Surprisingly, many of us do not know of this horrible chapter in our global history. Instead, what many know about the nadir of British colonial rule in India is through the figure of Mohandas or Mahatma Gandhi. And indeed, Gandhi played a significant role in partition as well. Standing up to colonial subjugation, Gandhi launched a grassroots campaign of nonviolent resistance. After decades of this civil unrest, the British Raj, burdened with huge debt after World War II, promised to leave India by 1947. And I show here, they literally have a countdown to the transfer of power behind them. It was not going to be a smooth transition, though. During their colonial rule, the Raj exploited caste hierarchies among Hindus, and equally importantly, aggravated religious differences between Muslims and Hindus. These antipathies were only growing with talk of independence. While Gandhi was associated with an arguably Hindu-based movement, another British trained lawyer, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, was fronting a Muslim one through the Muslim League. Jinnah advocated the division of India into two separate states, Muslim and Hindu, which Gandhi opposed. Eventually, though, guided by British colonial authorities, all relevant parties agreed to the division. In August of 1947, Sir Cyril Radcliffe enacted the national borders, now known as the Radcliffe Line, to formally enact partition. With these demarcations, the separate states of Pakistan and Bangladesh, known then as East Pakistan, were created. Violence erupted when stranded Muslims, Sikh, and Hindu minorities fled across borders to seek shelter in these newly created territories for their respective religious majorities. Within a few weeks, hundreds of thousands had been maimed, raped, and killed. In recent years, there has been a concerted effort to collect the oral histories and memories of survivors of partition, as can be seen here. As some of you may have noticed, many of the photographs of partition I have just shown were not taken by an Indian Hindu or a Pakistani Muslim, but by Margaret Bourke White. Bourke White is mostly known as a pioneering photojournalist and industrial photographer who found fame on the pages of Henry Luce's Life magazine, approaching her American subjects with both aplomb and sensitivity. Relatively unknown, however, is her extensive work in India, an assignment initially conceived by Luce as a shrewd opportunity to document the downfall of the British colonial empire. Bourke White's war assignments in such places as Moscow and Buchenwald, Germany, led to displacements of varying degrees. Suffice it to say, her mobility as a photographer of global conflict was a signal aspect of her identity and cosmopolitanism. Regarding India, Bourke White visited the subcontinent over the course of 3 years, 1946, 1947, and 1948. Each time, she not only had her camera with her, but also her pen. And after her last visit, she wrote this book about her experiences. Though there are many, one of the more striking images in her book is this: two weary boys perched high above a seemingly endless array of tents in a Muslim refugee camp in Delhi. Bourke White, her camera, these boys all share the same position. The boys telegraph the misery below. With a strong depth of field, the dyad composition balances the specificities of individual hardship with the magnitude of the crisis. In this sense, Bourke White reveals her social agenda, as she was profoundly moved by what she called, quote, the travail of a people divided by pen strokes, end quote. To be sure, Bourke White's sympathies were for the individual struggling against colonial powers, all of which reminded her of young America's struggle for independence. Perhaps one of Bourke White's most iconic images of Indian independence is this one, Gandhi sitting cross-legged on the floor, reading news clippings with the strong geometry of his spinning wheel in the foreground. Though the wheel is larger than Gandhi himself, and he is not spinning it, in our imagination, it is Gandhi's nimble intelligence that makes that wheel spin. Spinning was a daily ritual practiced by the leader and his ashram for 1 hour. And before Bourke White could photograph him, she was told she had to learn how to spin, which she did. Because it was also his day of silence, Bourke White was also told that she could not talk to her sitter, so she didn't. Thus, to be accepted by her subject, Bourke White had to enact a performative identity, however fleeting, acceptable to Gandhi's cultural community. This photograph belies, then, the acts of cultural fluidity and moments of transculturation engaged in by Bourke White. As this all suggests, Bourke White was more than an impassive observer behind a camera. Shoulder to shoulder with emerging leaders and key figures as highly charged transitions of power took place, she was deeply engaged with the burning issues, not to mention deeply committed to the people of that region. From Bourke White's West-East displacement, we turn now to Indian-born Zarina's East-West one. Though she was only 10 years old at the time of partition, and has lived and worked in New York since 1976, Zarina has devoted most of her career to the emotional and physical upheaval from that early part of her life. After studying mathematics at university and marriage to a diplomat, Zarina moved between a home base in New Delhi and extensive posts in Thailand, France, and Germany. Through this inherently peripatetic life, Zarina honed the techniques of her art. She studied intaglio with Stanley William Hayter in Paris, print and papermaking in Rajasthan, and Japanese woodblock in Tokyo. When she returned to India in 1968, she made a group of works that reveal some of these influences and a growing self-awareness of her displacements. In Door, we see a relief print that has the striated patterning of wood planks Zarina found in the New Delhi streets. Interestingly enough, the support is khadi paper from a New Delhi artisan collective founded by Gandhi to promote traditional crafts and revivify manufacturing shut down with the rise of British imports. Broken, imperfect, disorderly, Dore references psychic and material thresholds that Zarina can and cannot cross in her homeland. Home is a foreign place pictures more thresholds, along with various other architectural features of a home, methodically probing memory and the artist's desire for rootedness. Made from Japanese kozo paper, the work comprises 36 woodcuts, each captioned with a single poetic word in Zarina's native language of Urdu. Despite their asceticism and minimalistic syntax, the woodcuts evoke profound feelings of home, yearning, and dislocation. And the detail of fan, for example, on the right there, has in English, in pencil written, the word afternoon. So Zarina says that she couldn't imagine an afternoon in India without the ceiling fan going. This work is typical of Zarina's mature oeuvre. Prints that resemble maps and architectural plans adhere to a strict palette, and usually include beautifully handwritten Urdu drawn from her love of Indo-Pakistani poetry. This element of textuality registers centuries of an artistic heritage, of course, specifically the illustrated manuscript and calligraphic tradition of Islamic art. It also complicates the reception of her work, though, tugging at the task of translation that any displaced individual must endure. Zarina's feelings as a displaced individual were heightened during the events of September 11, 2001, where American Muslims from all walks of life feared of rising xenophobia. Her work since then has focused on exile and passage from more global perspectives. Whereas Bourke-White's photographs portray the human tragedy of partition as it was unfolding, Zarina's work relies on the poetics of abstraction and printmaking to reveal the intractable sense of loss constantly being reshaped by a survivor years later and worlds away. And I should note here, this work on the left, Dividing Line, is a woodcut referencing the Radcliffe line that I was talking about earlier. And instead of just gouging the dividing line into the block, she actually gouged out everything else. Zarina is an American citizen. She represented the United States in the 2011 Venice Biennale. But like many artists who leave their home country, she chooses to explore her displacement and fluctuations of cultural identity with transnational methods and idioms. Like Zarina, Shazia Sikandar considers herself a global and American artist. And she's in the middle in that this picture over here with Hillary Clinton, and yes, she is standing next to Jeff Koons. Born in Pakistan over 20 years after partition, Sikandar grew up in a nation that was still deeply hostile to neighboring India and disavowing its symmetries with Hindu culture as a result. In her artistic schooling in Lahore, Pakistan, after listening to a visiting curator from London's Victoria and Albert Museum discuss Indo-Persian miniature painting, talk about entanglements, Sikandar decided to train in the labor-intensive and historically rich art form, and I show you an example on the right. She employed such traditional methods as making her own squirrel hair brushes, pigments, as well as the vasli paper that then would need to be burnished. At the same time, Sikandar subverted the historical format by including personal narratives and unexpected non-Pakistani sources to create modern pastiches. And this is her senior thesis. Invited to show her work at the Pakistan Embassy here in DC in 1992, Sikandar decided to stay on, enrolling at the Rhode Island School of Design for her MFA. There, her experimentation grew bolder, leading her to explore freer compositional form and create miniatures with Hindu motifs that would have been discouraged in Pakistan. In Ready to Leave, Sikandar adheres, however loosely, to the internally framed image structure of a miniature, while discarding the requisite intricate border and blocking our view of the sitter's face, which is considered the most precious aspect of a miniature. Instead, she adds overtly Hindu elements, such as the Kangra motif of a woman at her toilette and Arapana, circular quasi-floral motifs from Bihar, India. And this is one right here. Other pastiche moments include the griffin, the ancient mythical composite of lion and eagle, which indexes Sikandar's own cultural hybridity and global mobility. It wears a veil, a symbol of Islamic culture laden with derogatory stereotypes. The artist openly acknowledges that, quote, such mixing of Hindu and Muslim iconography is a parallel to the entanglement of histories of India and Pakistan, end quote. The overall effect, then, is one of a dismantling, layer by layer, of a traditional structure to reveal strange yet familiar juxtapositions that lay beneath. In her work since then, Sikandar has continued to push notions of layering, whether through installations, murals, or digital animation, the latter of which she describes as a drawing-based practice. In the video installation, The Last Post, Sikandar digitally layers watery abstractions with drawings of a French horn, Mughal architecture, and miniature foliage in a celestial montage that culminates in a British East India Company figure being eviscerated. And that's at the bottom right over there. The work explores the fall of Anglo-Saxon power over China in the opium trade, as well as the looming British threat to the Mughal Empire. Accompanying this is Shanghai-based composer Du Yun's atonal arrangement, replete with explosions, static, and haunting voices. Sikandar's rendering of the English protagonist echoes the style of 18th century Company painting, where Indian artists pictured visiting European traders among the country's exotic furnishings and locales. With such moves, showing the intrinsically shared bonds between Hindus and Muslims and their common resentment towards British colonialism, Sikandar complicates assumptions about partition, revealing a viewpoint of an individual who didn't live through the cataclysmic events and seeks to minimize the enmity between Hindus and Muslims. Sikandar approaches the conflict between India and Pakistan not in terms of mourning and loss, as Zarina does, but as contiguous lands with common histories, emphasizing in her artworks a constant state of flux and her shifting sense of belonging and identity with those from Pakistan, India, and citizens of the world. Looking at Sikandar's miniature pastiches and decidedly postmodern views of selfhood, Zarina's minimalistic love letters to a lost homeland, and Bourke-White's pictures of mass migration and British colonialism's last breaths, my study aims to connect these little-known global narratives about partition. I realize the inherent difficulties in tying these artists and their displacements, each of whose oeuvre supports monographic inquiry, to each other and to histories and politics thousands of miles away from the United States. But what I propose is that moments of entanglement will be found along those many miles, knots of complicated transcultural negotiations hitherto unrecognized. Returning full circle to Ginny Yu's work, we can see how the question posed by its title, "Don't They Ever Stop Migrating?" leads to more questions, ones that need to be asked. Thank you.
Thank you, ShiPu. Thank you, Amelia. Echoing all of the thanks that have been going all day, the glorious organization that has brought us all here. And thank you to ShiPu for inviting me, a curator. Ethan mentioned there were a few of us here, I think actually only three of us presenting over the course of the 2 days. I am going to shift the tone perhaps a little bit, and in some ways my presentation will be a little bit more in keeping with Ethan's presentation this morning. I thought I'd start by mentioning that this notion of shifting terrains has also been preoccupying those who specialize in Latino art scholarship, with a fairly recent example of the 2011 Terra Symposium. It was called Encuentros, Artistic Exchanges Between U.S. and Latin America. And the upcoming 2016 edition of Latino Art Now, a conference that's sponsored by the Inter-University Program for Latino Research, which will convene around the topic, quote, reimagining global intersections. I think that key archival and curatorial revisions such as the Museum of Fine Art Houston's International Center for Art of the Americas, which is overseen by Mary Carmen Ramirez, and major biennials and triennials like Insight that existed in San Diego and Tijuana from 1991 to 2005, and the San Juan Polygraphic Triennial have opened up artistic, curatorial, and institutional channels that have put Latino and Latin American art practitioners more fully into dialogue. I'm here today to present what is still a provisional perspective on a large-scale regional initiative that will involve over 40 art museums, universities, and cultural institutions, and continues the challenging task of aligning Latin American and Latino art histories while simultaneously attempting to maintain the specificity of artists' outputs, national contexts, and institutional histories. In 2017, the Getty Foundation will present Pacific Standard Time LA, an initiative based throughout Southern California featuring over 40 exhibitions devoted to Latin American and Latino art. Unlike the first iteration of Pacific Standard Time, which took place from 2011 to 2012, with its tight Southern California regional parameters and strict periodization, LA is a broader, much broader, perhaps too broad, construct that will include a variety of curatorial approaches ranging from the titles of the shows, Luxury Arts in the Ancient Americas at the Getty Museum, to Talking to Action, an exhibition on social practice by Latino artists and artists from Latin America at the Otis College of Art and Design's Ben Maltz Gallery. Also, unlike the first Pacific Standard Time, Los Angeles is not subject matter, but instead offered as a platform for new scholarship. The original Pacific Standard Time Festival held over 6 months from 2011 to 12, featured seven exhibitions specifically on Chicano Latino artists, with the inclusion of Latino artists in numerous other group exhibitions, ranging from State of Mind, New California Art circa 1970, to Los Angeles Goes Live, Performance Art in Southern California, 1970 to 1983. Pacific Standard Time's first iteration was a belated attempt by Southern California exhibitions to respond to a round of European scholarship and curatorial endeavors, going back to Sunshine and Noir at the Louisiana Museum of Modern Art in Denmark, which took place in 1997. Los Angeles, 1955 to 1985, the birth of an art capital, which took place at the Centre Pompidou in 2006. And Time and Place, Los Angeles, 1957 to 1968, that took place at the Moderna Museet Museum in Stockholm in 2009. The unexpected yet highly fruitful result was a linking of over 60 museums, cultural spaces, and alternative art organizations that, in critic Michael Ned Holtz's accounting, created a, quote, networked dialectic of the one and the many. A number of the critical reflections on PST1, in particular the writings of Lucia San Roman and Malik Gaines, singled out an unexpected outcome, how the initiative had served to foreground the importance of so-called minority groups, including Mexican-American, Chicano, African-Americans, and queer and feminist artists. Examining the critical and institutional responses to PST1, as well as thinking through the scholarly and curatorial conversations that are shaping PST-LALA, my paper will address the complicated brokering of identities and the differing, yet at times overlapping, stakes for the fields of Latino and Latin American artistic production and scholarship. From what could be gleaned from the press release in support of LALA's launch, the rationale for the initiative is a noticeable shift from the PSD1's art historical imperative, instead to a narrative about recognizing an emerging majority Latino population. As the art newspaper reported, Latin America, especially the emerging economy of Brazil, has been a growing focus of the art market in recent years. But the Getty's choice of Latin America has more to do with Southern California's demographic than with art world trends, end quote. This leads me to question, who is this imaginary audience, and what does it want or expect? This has been a pressing issue, more so as subtext, during the curatorial workshops and lecture series that have been organized by the Getty Foundation in the lead up to its call for curatorial proposals. I should mention that the Getty gave over, it funded over 40 exhibitions, and at this point is now going into the second round, which they call the implementation grant round, that will open up even more. PST1 had 60 museums and organizations involved, so we're expecting there will be as many for LALA. While both Latino and Latin American artists, as well as those who investigate their work, have pushed over the last decade for inclusion and representation, the outcomes for each field have differed dramatically. There are concerns and struggles in both the Latin American and Latino art historical fields that overlap, reflected in the title for the ICAA's critical anthology, Resisting Categories, Latin American and or Latino. But there are also differences in vantage point. Structures of validation and legitimization will function differently because of differences, considering, as Tomás Ibarra Frausto articulates, Latino arts have been mainly created and disseminated apart from official cultural patronage and institutions. This points to an apparent paradox within LALA, as the presence of Latino artists, especially those whose practices are not easily integrated into mainstream, often market-oriented or art historically legitimized modalities, argue for a decentralized approach to this initiative. Latino Los Angeles's role in LA is worth consideration, since while the region has never been a stronghold of Latin American scholarship or collecting, it has generated or been host to major curatorial initiatives focused on Chicano and Latino art. For example, the Hispanic art of the United States was presented at LACMA. Chicano art, resistance, and affirmation showed at UCLA's White Gallery and included a number of Southern California artists and scholars on its planning committee. Aver, the first monographic book series devoted to Latino artists, operates from the UCLA Chicano Studies Research Center. And the Museum of Contemporary Art San Diego's Transactions was one of the first permanent collection exhibitions to emphasize its holdings of both Latino and Latin American art. And Phantom Sightings, Art After the Chicano Movement, an exhibition that I curated with Chan Noriega and Howard Fox, was generated as part of LACMA's Latin American and Latino Arts Initiative, something that actually Chan played an instrumental role in defining. So certainly there has been fruitful scholarship on the connections between Los Angeles, Latino Los Angeles, and Mexico. As the PST1 exhibitions, MexLA and LA Chicano made evident and advanced. But there's a paucity of scholars and curators focused on Latin American art, and the museum collections are behind those of Austin, Houston, New York, and Miami. Even the Getty Foundation seems to articulate this paradox with its statement on the LALA webpage. Quote, "Thus, while Los Angeles often represents the vanguard of contemporary culture in the United States, it is at the same time a Latin American city of long duration," end quote. I found that very intriguing, this very loaded, a lot to unpack there. So Houston, New York, Miami collector bases who have impacted institutional recognition. Expressing a concern that LALA runs the risk of overlooking Latino LA in its attempts to broker institutional connections, transnational institutional connections, a group made up of artist photography scholar Ken Gonzalez Day and curators Bill Kelly and Pilar Tompkins-Rivas held a number of community forums in Los Angeles and Tijuana and San Diego. The outcomes of these dialogues with artists and community activists were synthesized in the Getty-sponsored symposium LA-LA Place and Practice, held in May of this year. According to the organizers, the 2 days of meetings occurring in San Diego and Los Angeles, with some additional performances and interventions in Tijuana, would afford an opportunity to, quote, examine the difficult topics that arise when considering the complex terrain of Los Angeles, Latin American relationship. As Gonzalez, Day, Kelly, and Tompkins-Rivas wrote in their program notes for the conference, LA Place and Practice will inquire into the local side of the LA-LA equation. Los Angeles and the Southern California region extending in Tijuana, considering the direct relationships between local Latino arts communities, migratory experiences, and practices that cross the U.S.-Mexico border, and increased exposure to the variety of cultural practices at work in the region. The major questions were related to the realities of Alta and Baja California's and the over 3-decade-long consideration of how border politics has impacted the social and political relations between those in the United States, including Mexican Americans and Chicanos, and Mexico. As one participant wondered, is Tijuana / Los Angeles the beginning or end of Latin America? Furthering this line of questioning and in response to the symposium, with its multifaceted inclusion of alternative art spaces, artist collectives, poets, and scholars based on both sides of the border, critic Misael Diaz queried, what will it mean to implicate and include the communities, or at the very least, artists and cultural social practitioners working within Latino communities that will be presented by these institutions in a conversation at these relatively early stages of planning exhibitions garnering international visibility? Can communities become co-producers, participants, and or stewards of archives? How would popular archives shift the conversation relating to memory, history, documentation, and interpretation in relationship to Latin America locally and abroad? And these are just a couple of the participants in the Place and Practice Symposium, both LA-based, one LA-based collective called the South Almonte Art Posse, and another Rafa Esparza, performance artist based in Los Angeles. With those questions in mind, ethics and curatorial practice and institutional reciprocity have been crucial to the conceptualization of a universal history of infamy, the LA-LA exhibition that I'm co-curating with Jose Luis Blandet and Pilar Tompkins-Rivas at LACMA. I should also mention that LACMA will also serve as host to a monographic exhibition on the Chicano artist Carlos Almaraz and a show on the intersections of architecture and design in California and Mexico that is mainly focused on early to mid-20th century designers and architects. And, of course, importantly, a collaborative exhibition between the Museum of Fine Arts Houston with Mari Carmen Ramirez, Chan Noriega, and Pilar Tompkins-Rivas doing a show called Home. So back to our project for LA-LA. One of our project advisors, Pablo León de la Barra, has written, we can only speak of various diverse, heterogeneous, and coexisting Americas. Pacific Standard Time LA-LA set forward the enticing possibility of surveying contemporary art in the hemisphere and its relationship to Los Angeles. Yet such a notion contends with the conflicting definitions of America, the Americas, in America, as well as the circulation of these ideas in both a regional and global context. As such, the traditional model of the museum survey one that might sample an equitable number of artists with divergent practices from more than 20 countries, would fail in any attempt at comprehensive representation or a cohesive thesis for a global region that defies such constraints. Site then plays a significant role in our exhibition, both through artists' practices and in accordance with the broader questions of LALA that LALA conjures through Latin America's relationship to Los Angeles and vice versa. On the occasion of the 28th Biennial, Sao Paulo Biennial in 2008, curators Ivo Mesquita and Ana Paula Cohen titled the exhibition In Living Contact. This title referred to the comments of the first ever biennial curator, Lurival Gomez Machado, who wanted to place Sao Paulo in living contact with the international avant-garde. Decades later, this notion of bringing the authorized canon to the developing world has been contested. Our curatorial team wants to use the opportunity of LALA to deliver upon the initiative's promise of exchange and reciprocity. That LALA, that seems to be shifting and fluid, or so they would like for us to think. We want to redeploy the framework in living contact by positioning Los Angeles as a site for artists to expand upon their research-based practices. Without seeking to codify Latino and Latin American art historical canons, this exhibition offers the city of Los Angeles as a site of encounter, again the word, encounter between artists whose geographical and generational relationship to Latin America varies in accordance to geopolitical realities. Although I cannot speak at length of the entire group of artists that will be included in the exhibition, I would briefly like to go through a small representation. And here you see the work of Colombian and Korean American artist who's based in Los Angeles, Gala Porras Kim. Through the study of applied linguistics, Gala Porras Kim considers the strategies of resistance embedded in language and speech in specific cultures in Latin America. Focusing on what she refers to as invisible linguistic geographies, the artist will conduct research on the impact of colonialism on both indigenous languages, such as Zapotec, and in the formation of hybrid languages that have emerged in the Americas, such as Creoles and Spanish mixes, like Palanquero, a Kikongo-influenced language spoken in rural Colombia, and Spanglish. I'm just going to run through these. Vincent Ramos is a research-based artist based in Los Angeles who amasses and mines his own collections of pop culture ephemera, music, newspapers, magazines, advertisements, literature, and film memorabilia, and personal archives, family photos, letters, and tchotchke, to create complex installations often activated through audio, video, and performative components. Central to his work is the subtext of his own family's history, rooted in the Mexican-American experience of Venice Beach and Santa Monica, or rather, Southern California Latino subjectivities that filter Americana imagery produced by post-war Hollywood. Ramos's practice also expands to include others through curatorial projects and educational programs, as he presents questions surrounding the translation of memory, time, place, and our collective consciousness. For our show, A Universal History of Infamy, artist Carolina Caicedo will present two major works that function as a culmination of her multi-year project titled Be Damned, an investigation of power dynamics and social repression associated with the corporatization and decimation of water resources and rivers. In a room-sized multi-channel video installation, the artist conceives of overlaying river portraits. The principal imagery focuses on Cascada Las Damas, a waterfall in the town of Garzón, Colombia. Within the work, the landscape becomes doubled inverted and abstracted, leading to an unexpected encounter with a force of water. The river expands through additional video channels, at times translated through the act of drawing with a brush and ink, at times represented through the repetitive motions associated with the rivers, such as the gestures of net fishing, which Caicedo refers to as geochoreographies. And you also see an elaboration on this term that Caicedo has used, geochoreographies, in her performative or performance activist-based workshops that she's been conducting in Los Angeles and in Colombia. Throughout Naufus Ramirez Figueroa's practice, which encompasses performance, video, photography, sculpture, drawing, and painting, the artist references meta-narratives affecting his native Guatemala's history, such as major periods of architecture and their respective doctrines, pre-Columbian, colonial, modernist, exploitative neocolonial corporate interests in the country's resources, the harsh realities of the Guatemalan Civil War, and the experiences of being in exile. For this exhibition, the artist will produce sculptures, props, and costumes designed to commemorate the 1975 staging of El Corazón de Espantapájaros, The Heart of the Scarecrow, 1962, originally written in 1962. It is a play within a play by Guatemalan dramaturg and artist Hugo Carrillo that was enacted by art students in clown makeup in the roles of policemen, soldiers, and government officials. Carrillo's prophetic, satirical portrayal of a repressive government highlighted the level of lawless violence masquerading as state-sanctioned control. Ramirez Figueroa will work with contemporary collaborators to commission and perform rewritings of the play that will be staged in relationship to his installation. And in the interest of time, I think I'm just going to summarize the overlying interest for a universal history of infamy. This sort of thread that connects all of the artists is their interest in artist research or artist practice as a form of research, and this ethos of transdisciplinarity, which is not to state that this impulse is particular to Latin American or Latino artists, but the research and production of this grouping of artists reflects the dialogical nature of a globalized contemporary art practice. The strategies behind the exhibition production and its circulation engage with the transcultural emphasis of PST LALA and the potential of what this exchange might yield. Although the underlying imperative for the Getty and for many mainstream art museums in the U.S. is to develop exhibitions and programming that appeal, quote unquote, to a growing Latino demographic, there needs to be an acknowledgement of the uneven networks of validation and support for Latin American and Latino art. The research and curatorial phases for LALA have included, to quote Tomás Ibarra Frausto, the Latino perspective at the conceptual curatorial level, and that is ultimately where decisions about representation are made. Thank you.
All right, we have about 20 minutes to 25 minutes for the Q&A. So if you can get your question in, I'm sure you will seek them out and have more extended conversations throughout this two-day conference. So is there any question that you want to start?
I have a question. You can hear me? Hi, Jackie. I don't think you failed. Why do you think you failed? Tell us in plain language.
Can't we talk about this later?
Okay.
No, I mean, it's a gesture, right? And I don't know, sometimes I feel like we're in this self-congratulatory state and things are different and there have been successes, but clearly, you know, the world has always been on fire and it seems especially on fire now. And there's a moment where I go, why, what has this done, if anything? Not to say that I'm so narcissistic that I thought it was gonna, you know, change things overnight, but, or at all. But I mean, I mean, don't we all think that about our work? I thought so. It's coming.
Well, I would like to congratulate all three, four on the presentations. Wonderful panel. But I would like to ask Rita about the discussions in terms of the concept, because I think it's a very problematic, not I think, it is a very problematic concept as we're talking about
LA, like LA.
American or not American, Latino and Latin America mm-hmm. is also like a term and a concept that has been like widely discussed and criticized.
Yep.
And somehow in your presentation, it's not really clear of how much this discussion is coming into the curatorial perspective. I don't, maybe like a question also about how much is that like LA Latino culture, which mm-hmm. is one thing. And how much of the concept widens up to talk about like Latin America in LA, which is a totally different thing. Yes. You know what I mean? So it's not really clear for me how this is designed in terms of framing of the.
Yeah, I was trying to start to get at the complexities and the problems. Perhaps even the impossibilities. And I mentioned the ICAA's Resisting Categories, which is a compilation of decades of scholarship, essays and interviews and documentations of years of conferences that have really all been about this resisting the category of Latino and Latin American art. The Getty Foundation has sponsored two major, what they call workshops for the Los Angeles-based curators and those who are interested in proposing curatorial projects. And the first one took up with, I think, the entire half day was, again, a kind of continuation. And this agreement that there was this kind of begrudging need to use these terms. You know, we have to live with these terms, basically, and to use them strategically. And so that, I could have spent a lot of time also unpacking that. But what I really wanted to focus on was the quote-unquote local pushback or resistance, and that was through the activist scholarship and activist calls from Ken Gonzalez Day, Pilar Tompkins Rivas, and Bill Kelly to really examine this, which had not been examined critically by the Getty, Latino populations in Los Angeles. And so they were pushing for that. The Getty will also be sponsoring a major symposium on Chicano art. So these will all be hopefully incremental ways of influencing the shows, the types of shows that take place. As it stands, I would say it's a little bit more than half kind of skewed to Latin American, and it's heavily case studies, monographic, or institutional histories, which kind of continues with the PST1. So we were trying to do something different, which is really about really kind of taking LA at its word and thinking, okay, this is really about exchange and reciprocity. How can we do that? And is very much influenced by alternative art practice, by artist collectives. And again, I didn't really have time to go into that, but that's really the driving force behind our planning, which is a much more open-ended exhibition. I hope that answers somewhat.
Spreading the love here. Asma, this is for you. Hi, Asma. Thank you. Thank you all again for your presentations. That was great. I was really intrigued by your presentation and bringing the three artists together, and at the same time a little bit find it a little bit problematic, which you yourself pointed out. I, as a photo historian, I have to tell you that was a total intervention in the history of photography, and what you're doing on Margaret Bourke White is like fabulous. I knew nothing about that whole chapter, I guess, you know, the one famous photograph that sort of just slipped through all of the other things. And I think what I want to ask you and also encourage you to sort of tease out the real differences between what Margaret Bourke White was doing and your two more contemporary artists who are really rooted in that displacement narrative framework in a profoundly different way. At the same time, going back to the thing about thingness, I think the idea that photography should be looked at as an art object as opposed to looked transparently through it is a very intriguing way in which you're dealing with that. So my question, I guess, is more kind of a comment and a question in terms of engaging with the really clear distinctions, I think a real difference between what your two more contemporary artists, both medium, national construction, displacement, and how Margaret Bourke White fits into that narrative. That make sense?
Thank you. It does. There's several aspects of this project that I think are going to be challenging. I want to, kind of in the way that I'm deciding to flout categorizations by considering these artists together, I'd like to do the same thing in terms of how we focus on one specific medium within certain inquiries. I also think that her book is an artistic product, and her photographs become different things through the book, because there's a lot of this adjoining of text and image, which then carries new meanings. So I want to look at that very carefully as well. Another interesting point is that many Pakistani and Indian scholars who study the history of partition use Bourke White's photographs, as opposed to Indian photographers or Pakistani photographers. They use her photographs. The partition website that I showed you that is collecting the oral histories of survivors, it uses her photographs. Gushwant Singh, who wrote a novel called A Train to Pakistan in the 1950s, really the first literary representation of partition, uses Bourke White's photographs. So to me, it's not so much about how she's so different, but how they're all really intermixed.
So thanks for all of the papers. What, for me, I'm still struggling with is the difference between migration, immigration, displacement, because all of these were kind of mentioned in different contexts in the papers, and I couldn't help but thinking, for example, in your paper, Asma, about the displacement of Muslims who go from India, what is geographically today India, to go live in Pakistan. Because, you know, it's now been partitioned, and that's the giant, I mean, to me, that's the giant story of displacement there, not the story of people who come to the United States, right? That's a kind of minor story for me as someone who knows only very little about the period. So I wondered, you know, why or how the idea of the United States plays into your story, or whether that story of migration or immigration is relevant to that other bigger historical story. And then that gets to Rita Gonzalez's presentation too, where
I wondered if you could talk a little bit about one thing you didn't mention about the LALA thing, is how almost all of the shows, except I believe two, are about the 20th century, which is pretty amazing to me as someone who wants to take the question of what is the border and boundary between, you know, California and Mexico, for example, could be a very interesting question of this, you know, Latino, Chicano question. And yet, if you don't look at the 16th, 17th, or 18th century, you kind of miss that whole experience. So I wondered if that had come up in the two workshops and kind of your position on that, because I was surprised at how much this was a panel about the contemporary or drifted into the contemporary, which I didn't expect initially. So I guess that's a second kind of question that maybe could shed light, this idea of periodization and when we're looking at these problems in relationship to the terms everyone's using.
I'll just start briefly, yes. Because I think Asma has the tougher question in a way. My question is just about the, well, it's also a somewhat of a tough question, but you're absolutely right, and I think it's more like, I don't know, five or six shows that deal, that are not modern and contemporary. That's not a lot. And even those that are historical are really trans-historical and kind of seeking to bring in contemporary references. There is one in at the Museum of San Diego, and this is just working from my memory now, that is about indigenismos and will include contemporary artists as well. And it looks to be a kind of very provocative curatorial gesture in which maybe the scholarship that will be much more traditional in the catalog form than it will be actually as it will be articulated in the exhibition. But it's most definitely modern and contemporary in focus. And I think it's something that the Getty wanted to combat, but it's actually just by sheer numbers of the participating museums, there tends to be more of a modern contemporary. And I'm thinking of spaces like LACE that are involved, or Museum of Contemporary Art San Diego, MoCA LA, Orange County Museum of Art, now actually is in question of how it's going to participate. But this, by sheer numbers, the expertise as well of the curators tends to be more in modern contemporary. So I think it's just kind of a matter of really the lack actually of a range of exhibition possibilities there.
Thank you for your question. It's something that I'm thinking about deeply. I want to pay attention obviously to the different kinds of mobilities that I'm discussing here. That's obviously a big concern of mine. In some ways, though, partition, the displacement that occurred from partition, that migration to Pakistan, led to many people having a second migration to the United States. My parents wouldn't have come here. I wouldn't be here if they hadn't done that second migration because of that first migration. So to me, they're all interrelated. Mm-hmm. Secondly, in migration studies, the idea of trans-regionalism or trans-localism is something that's also becoming a hot topic. I was not going to bring that up because it completely changes the title of why we're here, but transnationalism is now starting to be problematized as too big, as flattening out the contours of too large of a geography, and that we really kind of need to consider scale and micro-exchanges. So that's something else I'm considering.
Hi, I have a curatorial question. Asma, I'm really excited about your project, and I've got the simple question and then the bigger question, which sort of ties into a comment that Ethan made earlier. My first simple question is this project an exhibition? you'll see from the rest of the question why. I hope it's an exhibition, and that's really exciting. but also I think challenging to our field in general. You know, Ethan made a comment about American art not being in the big American wing anymore, and then I was looking over at some of my friends from the big American wing in New York, and I was thinking about what we do at PAFA and what you do working at the National Portrait Gallery. And is this show going to be at the National Portrait Gallery, and what does that mean? And I was also thinking about my colleague Jody Throckmorton, who's not here today, but she's our contemporary curator, and she's interested very much in Southeast Asian art. And I want to introduce you, but when she was at a museum in San Jose, she could do shows like that. Now she's at PAFA, this Museum of American Art. Likewise, you're at the National Portrait Gallery. And I think there is this breaking down of boundaries, but then as curators, we're also dealing with collectors and institutions of a whole different world than the academy in a way. And so can you address that a little bit?
Really easy question there, Anna. I would like this to be an exhibition at some point, sure. I don't think that it would necessarily work in the National Portrait Gallery because we are about portraiture, and Zarina's work would really be making an elastic argument of portraiture. These are issues that we discuss pretty much on a daily basis at the National Portrait Gallery. The face of America has changed, and issues of identity are constantly being discussed versus what many people come to our museum for. So, very difficult, not easy to discuss questions right now.
Any question for Jackie?
There was a big one.
You're not resting.
I do have a question for Jackie. Or more of a request, really, to hear you say more bad things about the case study model. Because the other day I was thinking, I think I really hate case studies. I think I'm writing a book about why I hate case studies. And I thought that'll be interesting to no one. But maybe it'd be of interest to you, and maybe I would just like to hear more about how you think about that. Because the genius of the Making Race book is that it sort of disobeys that kind of imperative in the discipline to make every artist represent something. And it seems that part of what you're doing with that book and what you're pushing us to in the talk today is toward a model not exactly of representation, but maybe of sociability or of some, but I'm trying to think of some other ways to think about what the model is, if not the case study, because we're left, that's what we do, right? So help.
How much time we got? No, I'm sincere, and I do think the case study is really useful, especially when the links are made among artists. The sometimes, though, that there's a center, it might be a concrete center or an invisible center where the cases are organized around something that still holds its power at the center of the circle, and that doesn't then give the case study much power. They just become satellites, you know, like kites tethered to a post. And I especially get anxious about it when I see it being done for diversity, because it just becomes like a chocolate box. You know, here's the creme de menthe, here's the cacao, here's the, you know, the coconut one, you know, the rum cream, etc. And I mean, we have to do that for a way because it reminds us about a certain kind of visible diversity, but then we don't even actually then go deeper with thinking about what's diverse about diversity. You know what I mean? So that's when I get anxious about it. As a rubric, as a model, as a frame. I don't know that. So, it's both good and then it, you know, it's like anything. If you put your shoulder to it, it's good. But if you're doing it very lightly and not thoughtfully, it's not good.
All right, I think we are out of time. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Please head upstairs to the courtyard. We've got coffee there, and we'll resume in 20-ish minutes. Thank you.